Should we start or what?
I think so. Yeah, please.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. I am Mandira, and thank you for joining us today, students from DPS Gurgaon, as well as friends of the museum from all over the world. I presume everyone can hear me. To talk about Amarnath Sehgal, the private collection is a repository of artworks and archives of the Indian modern artist. The museum is based in New Delhi's Jangpura extension and intends to create a deeper awareness and appreciation of the artist's contribution to Indian art. The display in the museum points towards his versatility and nature as an artist, his investigations drawing attention to his constant vocation for exploring the expressive possibilities of any medium. One of Sehgal's aspirations had always been to help nurture creativity and help young talent. Today, his legacy lives on at Sehgal Museum, which hopes to serve as a catalyst in the field of art. So joining us today is a man of many avatars, critically acclaimed chef, restaurateur, farmer, author, and can I say photographer? Mr. Suvir Saran, from New Delhi. But before we start, I would like to say that please do share your questions and comments with us in the section below. There's a chat section, so you could just put that there. We can get to that after the talk. I will be sharing details about the museum in there as well for you to reach out later. Suvir Saran, to give a little bit of an introduction, has nurtured a lifelong passion for the traditional flavors of Indian cooking, earning 3 stars from the New York Magazine, 2 stars from the New York Times, and of course, the first Michelin star ever awarded to a US Indian restaurant, and also the first South Asian restaurant in America, I think. He has published 3 cookbooks, and now we have a very interesting book that he's going to talk about, Instamatic. So, Suvir, welcome, and please share with us your inspiring story of food, your drive, and creativity.
Thank you, Mandira. And I'm grateful to the Amarnath Sehgal Museum and the collective to have me over. It's an honor to be associated with a man that we've read about in art school and whose work has inspired so many of us across the world. So thank you to everybody that made this happen. My life is a story of Instamatic, Insta moments, and Insta wisdom and Insta revelations that open doors, opportunities, and avenues to a 20-year-old, 18-year-old who left home from Delhi to Bombay. When I arrived in Bombay, I had my lovely aunt Asha Bhua, who's one of the people here I can see on the screen. She opened her nurturing home to me, and with that taught me how to stitch, and she taught me how to garnish food and how to enjoy setting a table. Watching her was like watching poetry in motion. So Bombay, I learned how an amazing housemaker, housekeeper, host, and artist can function at all these many layers and levels. So in Bombay, not only did I study how to make art, but the school I went to was so boring and so didactic that it was my aunt and my friends that kept me going. But then at 20, I found myself in New York City, a city that was in the flux. It was like India is today in 2020, if you will. A city that was fighting its soul, that was fighting battles of racial inclusion, of sectarian divide between the rich, a class divide between the rich and the poor, and a city that was dangerous in some places and very plush and lush in others. And yet there I arrived in the first day at our School of Visual Arts in New York City. In the orientation class, they taught us how to avoid the stare of a mugger and how to handle being mugged. And I said, wow, this is quite the welcome to the city of my dreams. But what it taught me early on, New York, was to be very connected to life. And that in an instant, life could change. In an instant, you could go from being somebody who was lacking inspiration to becoming one that was inspired. And so the title of my latest book, Instamatic, isn't that incongruent to the story of my life. This is how I looked when I arrived in America at the age of 20. A man with long hair, not different from Mr. Sehgal's. I think artists and long hair can maybe go hand in hand. But this is me waking up in New York, So my teachers would think I was more a rock star, less an artist. And this is the city I used to call home till 2019. But in Manhattan, what I learned was that the city that had these incredible skyscrapers, tall buildings, incredible architecture, beautiful art and museums, was also a city of stories and souls, of aspirations and hopes, of dreams and the breaking down of dreams all happened. And to be grounded in that city, you didn't have to look up. You had to look at eye level and just a little above eye level. And you saw others like you that too were living in this utopia where magic would happen because you sought it, you found it, you discovered it, and you grabbed it while you could. And in between going to school and working as a retailer at the Metropolitan Museum of Art first, and then I worked at Henri Bendel and Bergdorf Goodman, then I became a caterer. I was cooking every day at 5:30 or 6 in the morning to take breakfast to my co-workers and employees at work. Then I would come home at around 6:30, 7 and start cooking to lay out dinner by 9:30, 10. And anywhere from 15, 20 to 100 people would show up at these dinner parties, depending on how much I'd planned and how many people I'd allowed to bring friends with them. And the who's who of the planet would show up, actors from Hollywood, visiting actors, struggling actors from Bollywood, who've since become big stars of Bollywood. They would all show up because they'd heard this one kid in New York cooks delicious food and has an open home, the Grand Central of eating. So here you can see some of my creations. The one with the white dusting of cheese on top is a Bengan ka bharta bruschetta. So it was a bruschetta made with bharta with a raisin chutney drizzled on top of it and a sheep's milk cheese as a garnish. The one on the bottom right are my lemon rice arancini. So these are lemon rice balls in a green curry made with curry patta and mint and cilantro. And then it has a oil made with basil. And then you have a tomato chutney and marigold blossoms. So that's the dish that we would serve at the restaurant. I think Nandita Didi and Rajan may have had it at Tapestry. The one on the top right is a pavlova that my mother had taught me when I was a young kid. Mom would make us lots of egg-based dishes, including il flotan, pavlovas. So this is one of the dishes Mom had taught me. When you crack the meringue, you have this pool of saffron-scented lemon curd and passion fruit sorbet inside it, and then macerated berries. So I was cooking, teaching, living, and enjoying life. And then all of a sudden, in the year 2010, I moved to San Francisco for 19 months to open a restaurant. And San Francisco showed me another face of New York. Here, in the middle of the night, I lived in the tallest building of San Francisco in the penthouse apartment on the 34th floor. And from 10:30, 11 at night till 5 in the morning, this was the light going from this to a little darker. And I would sing. I would just sing songs to the city. I would sing my ode to life and living. And in those dark spots between the buildings, I would see these stories of human beings talk to me. People who had been forgotten, people who had been disenfranchised, people who were being racially profiled, people who were not being allowed the same good luck that I had been given. So these little crevices of darkness would show me that. And so this is a view from the window there. And San Francisco, the restaurant I'd gone to open, never really came through, because the city and the landlord were fighting about what this restaurant should be. We had rented a space for 400-seat restaurant and were paying $100,000 a month rent. The city had told the landlord they should only have a bodega, a dry cleaner, a shoe cobbler, a grocery store, all these many buildings, many businesses together in the same space. We had spent a couple of million dollars to construct it. In the end, the landlord was sued by the city. We had to give it up. But I learned a lot about humanity in this city, because you had the richest of the world living with some of the poorest in a grand city. And I learned what it means to care and to be empathetic. So, you know, everywhere in life, I would learn lessons. While still living in the city, I also maintained our farm in upstate New York called American Masala Farm. So the yellow building that you see in the foreground is the guest cottage. Behind that is the main house. And it was a home from 1779, where the earliest parts of the house and the most modern were 1842. We were the second family to ever live in the home. The first family was a general who won the war for the Queen, the French-American War, and he, in winning the war for the Queen, he got this parcel of land, and when their family sold it, we bought this farm. It's a to the heritage building and a heritage site. We maintained it as such. So I learned how to enjoy nature, but I also learned that people make nature more than just nature. This is a pond that I would look at from my window in the kitchen as I cooked for people. This is in fall, when everything was falling and the world looked bleak. At the ugliest, this is what it looked like in winter. In winter, you think of, it's the cold season, but what I learned by spending winter days in minus 30 degrees was not the coldness of the temperature, but how a cold heart can be even more damaging and dangerous than a cold geography. That, you know, the human spirit, when it's bereft of empathy and kindness and generosity of spirit, it's even cooler than ice and cooler than snow. So I learned how to appreciate nature, but also study humanity for a lack of warmth. That's what the farm taught me. This is a farm in fall, a moment of seasonal bliss. The colors were incredible, but we also realized that the dropping leaves were nature keeping its storing its energy for the cold that was to come. This was, I was cooking while going back and forth from the farm to the city, lobster tails with a cilantro raw butter toast and a drink made out of bell pepper. So, you know, color would come not just by the outside, but also on the table. And then the crab apple tree, that magenta, navy blue of India, the pink, with the incredible water-laden skies where a storm is about to come. This, all of this told me about the power of nature over humanity and mankind, and how helpless we really are if our ego takes over. And while doing that, I would go back to the city and cook. This is a steak that I've made with root vegetables that have been caramelized on the foreground. And at the back is a vegetable baklava made with confit tomatoes, sauteed spinach greens, and pureed beets in between phyllo dough that has herbs that have been baked into it. So we were here. I was living a very rugged life and then making this very fanciful food all at once, the plurality and dichotomies of life coming to fore. This is the farm in summer. Our ducks and geese you can see between the yellow guest cottage and the green of the pond. You can see those little white creatures. Those were my favorite animals ever. My partner Charlie coming from feeding the animals. How could anybody hate or question another human being after seeing such beauty? I learned how to live wholly at the farm, but I also learned never to become a human devil. Because, you know, when human beings forget that they are one with the other, we become terrorists and miscreants and hate mongers that literally denude the planet of its beauty. So I would go back and forth, but then the anchor for me always was the city of Manhattan. Here you can see the World Trade Center in its new form. And this is me in New York City in Madison Square Garden area. The rain is pouring. What I would see here was the energy of Superman and Spider-Man coming to fore. That life never stopped. Rain, storm, New Yorkers kept going. But what were we chasing? We may be chasing money, but we were also chasing that dream of us being one as humans that came from small and big towns to make it big in Manhattan. A city where everybody was equal, you had equal opportunity. If you were smart enough to grab them in an instant moment, you could become just about anybody you wanted to be. So all these cars buzzing about, the human spirit always was grounded in Manhattan. And here I've made a dish that the New York Times did a story on, the sauce, the kurma, that cream sauce with the nuts on top of it, is a kurma made with 51 spices and aromatics. 51 spices and aromatics have gone into that white sauce. The meat underneath is a leg of lamb. And then you have caramelized cipollini onions and caramelized mooli, and then rutabaga puree. So, and then what the blue flour is a corn flour, summer flour, that when it was fresh and blue, I put toasted cumin powder in it and then let it dry in the sun. So when you bit into it, you had the flavor of Bhuna Zeera coming out. And I also, as an artist, I always wanted contrast. So the blue of the plate comes alive with the blue of the garnish. And then the yellow marigold blossoms, the baby marigolds, are a beautiful contrast to the blue of the plate. So the artist that I guess I'm told I am, came out visually in a plate as well. And Manhattan would make these things possible. And here you again see the steak from another angle. My last restaurant in New York and me. This was a skyline that I left in 2019, December 31st, 2018. I left Manhattan up because of being sick. And the car ride that was taking me to the airplane for a wheelchair to take me to the plane, I turned around and this is what I saw from the back of the car. And this was my home for 26 years. And this home, in all those buildings, in between the buildings, and in the water, sun, air, and life of Manhattan, were all the dreams I had dreamt and all the moments I had cherished for 25, 26 years. And then as I bid it goodbye, I was crying and I was sad. But then I stopped in between making home in New York and Rwanda. And here you see these Rwandan women that are stitching. They're stitching to sell clothes. But Rwanda taught me about how people can stitch together the broken pieces of their broken dreams, broken memories of their strife that they've gone through. Because in Rwanda, the two tribes butchered each other. Today, warring tribes have come together to marry amongst each other, make children, and live peaceably. And so I always say that these women seamstresses, they taught me about you can stitch together a life worth living and a life that gives others some reason to believe. So if Rwandans could forgive and forget and heal, so too can people who are Hindu, Muslim, Christian, Sikh, Jewish, and other, that we all should be able to forgive and heal, not divide amongst each other. So that's what I learned in my stop in Rwanda. Then I arrived in Tuscany, not once, but twice before moving back to India. And I was here in Florence at this gorgeous gilded church from the Renaissance period. And I realized how beautiful it was, how much gold leaf had gone in the decorating of this church, and how many incense sticks were burning inside. But the scent I sensed was the smell of sulfur, of the devil, that religion of religion that has been taken over by egotistical men that are robbing human beings who are from another religion the right to live and breathe and express and come to fruition as adults. A religion that can have all this opulence, but also have people just outside its church, hungry and without a roof over their head. So the contrast taught me about the importance of charity beginning with us, not the other. And there was a song that Tagore used to sing, Jodi Tore Dakshane Kyo Naashe Tobe Ekla Chalore. When you call out and nobody comes, you have to walk alone. So this church told me that it's not enough to say somebody else will deal with it. As thinking brains, as blessed humans who have a roof over their head, who have food at their table, it's imperative for us to speak up, to be the people who are affecting change, not leaving it upon others to do that. And then I arrived in Singapore. Through this journey from New York to New Delhi, for 11 months, I was legally blind. I could see 3 feet from one eye and nothing from the other. And more than anything else that was killing me, it was the inability to see that was eating me from the inside. And I'm ashamed today to tell you that I felt like a spoiled brat complaining about life, giving up on life because I couldn't see. And I have to think about all those incredible men and women who had never had sight, who go about their days being decent citizens, being incredibly talented people, being kind and forgiving. Members of civil society, never complaining about their lack of vision. And here I was, a grown man feeling like a little baby. So I learned not to cry and complain because I saw others had much less and they were smiling. And here I was in a mall in Singapore, dining with my cousin Gautam, a successful banker. And while they were all eating their dim sum, I shot this photograph. I would shoot photographs, not because I thought there was art in them. I would shoot them to see the world that I couldn't see. And in this image, I saw a young boy who looked like me, not in his looks, but the same age that I was in Manhattan when I arrived first in New York City. And I said, see, he's staring somewhere. And I used to stare like that, just into the oblivion, because I had no idea who I was. And I realized we all have a journey to make, a story to tell, dreams to realize, and hopes to accomplish. So I, in this image, I saw that. And I wrote a piece that was, I think, 300 words long. And I posted it on social media. And the next day, Frances Mays, the woman who wrote Under the Tuscan Sun, the largest published book in man's history, she called me and she said, Suvir, your writing is food for Proust. You must write a book now that's not a cookbook, but a book of words. And then my publisher came to me and a couple of other friends, and the idea of Instamatic came. But the reason I share that is that these, when you live life with open eyes, when you live life of a artist who squints and pauses, who takes breaks between doing what other people have told them to do, life is always sending gifts away. Life is forever giving us opportunities to grab. Life is forever giving us reason to live. We just have to give life a chance. And that's why I say Instamatic, because every second that we live and breathe, there's an opportunity coming away from the everyday functioning of life. Like time will live with or without us. We have to learn to become one with time. So here I was in Singapore on my way coming home. This young kid taught me that I too was young once. And my duty day at 47, I'm now 48, and that time I was 46 going on 47. I realized I had to become a mentor. I had to become a teacher. I had to become a guide. I had to be the pillar of support and the opener of doors for others that age who are coming of age, who also have dreams and aspirations. Because when I arrived in New York, I would reach a place and doors would open, and then further doors would open from them to new opportunities that all made me sing, dance, and smile with glee. So it's now upon me to open those opportunities for others. So that's what Singapore taught me. And then I arrived in India January 1st of 2019. And I was going to my cousins in Noida, and on my way from the Barapulla Bridge to Noida, this is what I saw. And I said, look, we keep saying how beautiful Italy is and how beautiful all these other countries are, but in abject poverty in the Nizamuddin Basti, look at the colors in those homes. And if you pause, it makes you realize those lives matter too. They are beautiful too. They have struggles, they have strife. And we, instead of just dreaming of Italy and France and shores beyond our borders, if we invest in these people, these lives, and our own, there's so much beauty there, and there's also much to support there. So my first day in India taught me this as I was riding from South Extension to Nizamuddin. And this was the place where I had morning tea with my mom. And I looked up at the Indian sky. The blue was very gray, with full of pollution. But my mother's smile, my mother's belief in me, and her ability to nurse a grown man 24/7 on her bed. I was a big man who couldn't walk or really do anything, and she nursed me back to health. For 18 months, I've spent morning and night in her bed, and I would dream with her and think with her. And then the monsoon came, and the monsoon of Delhi, this is a photograph I took from our windshield. And this is one of the images that clinched the deal for publishing the book. People would tell me, what are you photo? Is this a painting? And I would say, it's a photograph. A photograph taken while the windshield wiper is moving. And just between the strokes of the wiper, I would click the iPhone. And it is, it's a impressionist photograph, if you will. And again, it's not what it shows you, it's what it doesn't show you that talks to me. Because it tells us about the cloudiness, the noise in our minds, the lack of, the distractions that we allow to rob us of our humanity. You know, as young kids going to school, my parents, my grandmother, my religion, my communities, my secular constitution, what it taught me was to think about the other as us. When you place yourselves in the shoes of the other, the monster that you saw in them didn't exist. When you saw your own grandfather in another neighbor's father, that grandfather couldn't be a monster even if he were another religion. So when you know, in Sufi poetry, they say, in bin unbin anbin nukta yaar sikhaya, that when you see the human being in all the others around you, we are all the same. There's no difference. So in this image, it's not what I see, it's what I can't see beyond that haunts me. That if I have the luxury of sitting in a car, saved from the ambush that the monsoon rain is having on the world, how lucky am I that I can look at these people and see beauty while they are having to struggle in without shelter in the grip of that deluge. So, you know, you have to always, when you think you're too smart, too good, better than the other, you are. And so you have to work for those that aren't, that don't have all the luxuries you have. So this image showed me how much there was still to do. But, you know, I brought the farm to India with me. So this is, we had barely moved into our home. These trees were coming. And I remembered that friends in New York would tell me that Charlie and I had a Hollywood farm. And I said, why do you say that? We had transplanted big plants into our farm so that without having to wait 40, 50 years for the tree to mature, we could bask in their shade and in their flowers immediately. So we spent the expense of buying large trees and large plants, and we did the same for Delhi. This is the beginning of the garden. Why did I need a garden in the city? For me, city life, as a human being who loves humanity and people and diversity and plurality, living in a farm was actually torturous. I didn't live at my farm in New York to be in a farm. I lived there to raise chickens. I had 200 chickens, 100 ducks and geese, and 50 guinea hens, and around 48 alpacas, and a partridge and a pear tree. So I did not go to the farm to chase plants, greenery, and nature. I wanted a place where I could raise chickens, hug them, kiss them, have them jumping on top of me, and be one with them. The human beings that I saw around the farm were people that you can see in many places and cultures and cities around the world, people who had been neglected. In rural America, as in rural India and small town India, you have a lot of class divide. You have the rich and you have the poor. The poor have been ignored. They've been forgotten. They've been disenfranchised. They don't have the same amenities. In Manhattan, I had fiber optics connecting me to the world. In upstate New York in 2019, I had a dial-up modem to contend with to get online. A lot of my neighbors never went online. For them, it was interweb, not internet. They looked at somebody like me and thought terrorist. While my Hindu friends think of a Muslim as a terrorist, in America, your Hindu brother is considered a terrorist. So, you know, that was the ugliness of being the other. So that's the reason I hope that all my fellow Hindus and Muslims realize that in lands afar, no matter who we are, when we are the other, we are also being hated in the same way we hate the other. So for me, a city with green plants is even better than a farm with a lot of greenery, but ugliness around it. Donald Trump isn't a freak of nature. He was created by the very communities and people that were ignoring others. You know, he got elected because there are so many people in America that have been forgotten, that have been treated like second-class citizens because they're poor. So the poor are voting in a prime minister president who is not good to them, but they've given up on the electoral process because they wanted a change. We are seeing similar hate-filled bigotry creeping in cultures across the world, and we have to guard ourselves against that. It's very easy to divide us between Hindus, Muslims, Sikhs, Christians, Jews. Please, we shouldn't be allowing it. Because at the end, if you kill one, you'll be killed by the end. Blood and anger doesn't have any favorites at the end. It kills the same people who are spreading the hate. So let's all think like artists. I was reading, watching an interview with Mr. Sehgal on partition. And what I realized was this incredible man, an incredible artist, telling us to look at the commonality, the common human experience across the toxic border that we share with that nation. People are the same, whether we speak in Urdu or Gujarati or Marathi or Tamil. Our Indian collective, our subcontinental aspirations and dreams and hopes are pretty much mirroring each other. So why allow ourselves to be divided by religion, which in its essence is what should unite us? So these plants were to teach me about the people I never wanted to become like, not to give me oxygen. Oxygen I get from city life, by living with people who fight all the divides and become one with our common aspirations. This was a, I was in the Barak, the Chausat Khamba, this monument in Nizamuddin. And this photograph, sorry, it's been cut a little short. The human being in scale is 1/10 of the size of the monument. And I wanted to show this, to show us that in the time of Amir Khusro, this monument was built. It has lasted through all those years. And who's the small one here? The human being who's going to enter the shrine, not the monument. The monument stands proud as a legacy of people who thought bigger than themselves. People who created not for their own mere ego, of course, it was a driving factor, but wanted to leave legacies. So when you think of art, when you think of what you want to do, realize that what you think today should be so big that 300-400 years from today, people still consider it something worthy. So think much bigger than yourself and your selfish ego to create something that stands the test of time. My restaurant in Gurgaon, the House of Celeste, we were to open March 28th. We closed on March 21st. We had started doing family and friend dinners. We had opened what they call silent opening without making a noise. But our formal opening launch was the 28th of March. So we really never opened formally. But this is a restaurant, and it was a labor of love with a beautiful team of professionals that helped me bring food to the table. This is a golgappa that you were given, and you put it in one bite in your mouth and all the water comes pouring out. But for me, you are what you eat. So if you eat food that's beautiful and inspiring to look at and delicious to taste, you want the battle you have. And as an artist, you are then able to give people something to aspire to become. And so this was my journey to India. But the one thing I learned from India was to always believe in each other, believe in plurality, believe in the human collective, the collegiality of the human race, and how we were taught in our school that bikhre bikhre tare hain hum, lekin jhilmil ek hain, hum sab bhartiya hain, apni manzil ek hain. And these songs of our founding fathers were so rich that in America, when somebody was racially bigoted towards me, I remembered these songs of Gandhi, of Tagore, of our freedom movement. Tum Ram kahove Rahim kahe dono ki garaz Allah se hai. Tum Deen kahove Dharma kahe mancha to usi ki raah se hai. Tum Ishq kahove Prem kahe matlab to usi ki chaah se hai. Kyu ladta hai murakh bande? Ye teri kham khayali hai. Hai ped ki jad to ek wahi, har mazhab ek ek dali hai. So whenever somebody called me a brown man, effing Arab, a stinky terrorist, idolatrous Hindu, a smelly curry boy, I remembered these songs of favorites of Gandhi. And it taught me that, you know, forgive this man because he doesn't know what he's doing. And I would smile and rise above and not hate back. So I think it's time for all of us to remember that we make mistakes so another can make a mistake, but we shouldn't allow mortal egos, mortal padre, whether it's a mullah or a pandit or a rabbi, to tell us how to love and live. Religion divides if it is ruled by humans. When it's godly and spiritual, we all are one. And in our one collective, in the oneness with the divine, we become one with each other and life is beautiful. So that's the story of this misbegotten artist who began his life as a visual artist and ended up being a chef. And today I chair the Asian Studies Center, the Culinary Institute of America, the world's largest cooking school. I never went to learn cooking. And I became a Goodwill Ambassador for the United Nations Alliance for Civilization. They asked me to bring food to tables where people of disparate religions were warring with each other and how food can heal. So artists have the ability to transcend isms and divides. And I think everybody can. We have to find the artist in us. And we can all be kind, generous, decent human beings. It's easy to hate. It's a little more challenging to love, but our nature is to love. Stop listening to people that tell you the other is bad. When we see humanity in all, we become one with ourselves. and one with the divine. And when you're one with divine, the art you create is amazing. So that's my spiel for the day. Mandira, did I take too long?
No, not at all. In fact, it was quite interesting. We'd love you to share more also. But thank you so much. It was very, very interesting. And I'd say how beautifully you've captured just life in your pictures and just things that we'd miss on an everyday basis. And it's right in front of us. And how you've shown us about nature just overtaking mankind. It's amazing. And I'm truly jealous of your farm, by the way.
I loved it. As I said, the people around the farm, some were very good, but a lot were living in a cave. The cave that we are seeing today around the world that tells you my religion is better than the other. I was a Hindu hated by Christians. I was became a Muslim that both hated. So if they looked at my face, they didn't know whether I was Hindu or Muslim. But those Christian neighbors hated me no matter what. They didn't care whether I was Hindu or Muslim. They hated me as being the other. And that's the reason it's a very powerful message that we should not allow religion to divide us. Because, you know, there's a Saadat Hassan Manto was a Pakistani poet who said, "Khoon to khoon hai, tapkega to jam jayega." Hindu ya Musliman, kisi ka bhi khoon ho, khoon to khoon hai, tapkega to jam jayega. So, you know, we have to, those lessons that our poetry, Urdu poetry, Hindi poetry, Maithili Sharan Gup, Mahadevi Varma, these were incredible souls that have taught us in India for millennia that we are jhilmil jhilmil tare hain, hum bikhre bikhre tare hain, lekin jhilmil ek hain. That our culture is beyond that and we are becoming more like the organized religions of the West in hating, because our religion was about being inclusive. And I hope India can go back to being the inclusive country, because we have so much to share with the world. Because our religion rose, whenever other religion went down, we rose high. So that's the India we must remember. And the farm was void of that humanity that India had. In India, you go to a village, the poor give you food, they give you warm welcome, they smile. A poor man who has nothing, no limbs, looks at a rich person with a Chanel bag and a diamond, he doesn't kill them, he smiles and says namaste. That's the humanity of India. We must never forget it. Nandita Didi, do you have something to say?
Yes, actually I do. I wanted to ask Suveep, you've talked about creativity. Is creativity inborn or can you cultivate it? And how do you nurture it? Because I can see from your journey that you've had creativity as an artist, as a chef, as a photographer. Creativity can be in science, it can be in every field of life. You need out of the box thinking. How do you nurture that?
So, you know, I had a grandmother who was a very tough cookie. I would be lying if I said it was easy to be around Dadi for everybody. She loved us. She was very exacting with my parents. They had to follow a lot of rules. But us kids, she loved blindly. My parents loved us blindly. We were the outliers in our family, where other relatives were telling us their kids were coming first in class. My parents would love telling them we were failing in school. But what they never did was, they didn't lie, but they also never told us what to do. They knew their children had some, they knew we were kids, we were growing. And when the results would come, the relatives who were kids were coming first, were coming in the bottom level of the 12th exams. We were shining in the higher levels. My parents, in not lying about who their kids were, they allowed us to live. They allowed us to be ourselves. We had to touch the feet of elders. We had to lift the bags of the neighbors who were above a certain age walking around the streets. Papa would tell us, go walk the lady or the gent to their home. They allowed us to do what we needed to do as long as we were civil members of our society. And my school did that. At Morden School, I was the only kid till that year in 1991 that gave 7 board exams. I went to school to study. I did my 12th grade in science, physics, chemistry, biology, math, and English. Those were my 5 science subjects. Then I did a board exam in art, in fine arts, and also classical Hindustani music. I gave 7 board exams. My teachers, I would bunk classes. I would take a chemistry class every 3 days because I had to take music and art classes as well. So the school was very adult. They allowed this young kid to bunk classes. I would fail in my exam, but they knew my mind was there. The marks were just reflective of my distraction. So my principal, I went to him, I said, why did you allow this? He said, we believed in you. We knew the system would fail you, but we believed in who you were, how you were going about doing things. I think all of us can be creative, but to be creative, you have to inculcate humanity. You have to believe in yourself. You have to be given the freedom to think. To think means to not believe in dogma, to not believe in ritual, but to believe in that reverie, in that fantasy, in that magic you see way beyond your scope. When a child is allowed to dream bigger than his largest dreams could ever be, that parent, that society, that community is a community of people who want tomorrow to be rich for their young. We were never told to stop dreaming. Our relatives often called us badmash and this and that. My parents, as long as we were not rude, they never yelled and screamed at us. My mother, I did knitting, I did tatting, I did crochet, I did needlepoint, I did macrame, I did shadow work, I did chain stitching, I did sculpture, I did oil painting, I did calligraphy, I learned Urdu. A Maulvi Saab would come to home to teach me the Kaida with Roshnai on a Takti. So my grandmother said, "Ito Kaya's tradition hai, karo sikho." Nothing was, sky was the limit. If I wanted to do something, my parents would make it happen. They never stopped us from dreaming because they felt a child's scope is a blank canvas. The colors that the person gets painted to be is a mirror reflection of the society they grow up with. If you're a hateful bigot and a murderer, society has made you that. You weren't born like that. So we have to realize that our dreams, our aspirations, our hopes are a reflection of the society we grow up in. And that's why it's so imperative on us to be large, empathetic human beings, because there are kids around us watching us, seeing us about how we are. My parents never stopped this boy to be the creative boy. Nobody called me a sissy. Some friends and relatives did. My father would let them know it's inappropriate to call somebody those names. So my father would tell people, oh, he's the most creative child. He never said, bunai kyo karta hai, silai kyo karta hai. Karo, my mother would teach me how to make lehengas. I did dresses I would make. I made leg warmers for my classmates who were girls. Nobody ever questioned. For them, creativity, whatever, however I wanted to express myself, I was allowed to thrive. Sameer loved numbers, do numbers. He played football, play football. All my mother did was, she said, you have to play one game. I said, why, mom? She said, Baba, it will teach you discipline. It will teach you how to count. It will teach you how to be on time. So I took a tennis lesson with my mom in a sari, tying up a sari a little high and going to Gymkhana Club to learn tennis. Then they got me a coach. But they gave us every opportunity to break all the norms and be outliers so that we could be the same larger than life characters that my mom and dad were. My mother, now that my father is dead, has become this incredibly big human being. I said, Mom, you've changed. She said, Baba, I never changed. Your father was so big that if I also showed myself, we would be hitting each other. So she said, now you think your father would have married somebody who was a shrinking violet? I said, no. She said, you have to realize one person has to let the other bloom. So these two big people allowed us to be whatever we wanted to be. I think everybody has the ability to be an artist. The artist has to be encouraged. That's all. Rajan, did you have something to say?
I have a kind of follow-up. So first of all, congratulations. What an incredible story and beautifully sewed up together as the dresses you did when you were a kid. There's no question. Lovely. My question to you is, a creative life the way you have, is there a plan that you have? Like you plan your dishes. You know what you're going to create. You plan them meticulously, what it is, the flavors, the colors, etc. And you showed us the beautiful photographs. Is life planned, or do you think life has to be a rolling stone down the mountain?
Rolling stone down the mountain any day. I'm sure you had this conversation with your father, Rajan. The beauty of life is that with or without us, it goes to tomorrow. And the best amongst us become one with life. And when you become one with life, the seasons, the region you're in, the festival that is being celebrated in the community, the harvest that a farmer is bringing to the table, the pottery a ceramicist is making, the textile somebody is weaving, the glass another artist is making, when you put them all together, those plates, the spoons, the glassware, the vegetables, the temperature, they all tell your artistic brain, make this dish. I don't plan my dishes. The dishes bring it out of me. Nature tells me this is what's in season. This is where you're living. The people you have around you enjoy XYZ. Their desires, their tastes, their wants, the moment I'm around in time, that dictates who I am. Mom taught me at a young age a lesson for life. If you, your lips, could keep from slips, 5 words described with care, to whom you speak, of whom you speak, how, when, and where. 5 words. So that relates to also cooking and art. You have to remember where you are, to whom you're presenting your dish, who's going to be eating it, when are they eating it, and why are they coming to your table. All of those nuances should matter. And if you succeed in pleasing all of those nuances in a person's temperament, then you've given them a winning meal that brings satiety. So it's about regionality, seasonality, what's happening in society at any given time, the temperature of the day, the season in the year, all of that comes into play. So I think a good artist is connected to the pulse of life and living. And when they're one with the pulse of life, they become one with themselves. And then they create what is in sync and congruence with nature, not fighting with it. To be in harmony with nature makes you the best artist you are.
Lovely. Thank you.
Questions, anyone?
Subir, if I may, this is Sanjeev.
Hi,
Sanjeev. Hi. So Subir, absolutely inspiring. This is the second time I'm hearing you. But every time I've heard you, it's been a great learning, a true example of, the role your parents have played and the self-belief that you had, and a beautiful journey. And I come from the corporate world. And I think the point that you made was that there's so much, I think, the corporate people have to learn from the artists. From the art people from different disciplines. It's been a great learning for me.
So Sanjeev,
No,
go ahead, finish your question.
So I think my point was, when you look back when you were 20, the thought that came to you to move from the country, 2020, do you think the youth, the Subir 2020 would have the same thoughts and the same pull factor to move to US and achieve and think and mold yourself the way you have now?
You know, it's a very tough and a very easy question to answer, but there are 2 parts to it. Let's talk about the corporate part first. I think corporations and finance and money and economies are not an enemy of the arts. In fact, the greatest patronage comes in the greatest times of wealth for humanity. The Medicis are a fine example of how money and wealth can be used for the overall benefit of the larger community and mankind. So I think not every person who's in the corporate world is a terrible human being. I think I think the artists also have to give enough of a jolt to the community that rich people can get jostled in their head and see something amazing there. So it's also upon an artist to communicate. Not every artist deigns it okay to communicate successfully. So I think some artists are able to translate their art into lucrative success through a lot of hard work. They're geniuses because they've gone through, they don't have just an ego. They realize to benefit the larger social fabric of mankind, they have to let go of ego that says, I'm not going to talk to that person. They rise above, they talk, they communicate, they sell their art. And in doing so, they heal minds, bodies, and souls. Because a lot of these people working in corporations want art. They want to express, they want to be able to paint, they want to be able to sing and dance. But when they see an artist who's willing to relate with them, in that union, new art is created. So I don't think we have to create a divide between the two. I have lots of friends who are successful bankers and investment bankers and doctors and scientists who are more artistic than I can ever be. But they're also amazing patrons of the art, so I bow to them for being incredible human beings. About the 20-year-old Subir going to America in 1993 and the 20-year-old Indian boy today perhaps going there, a lot has changed, both in India and abroad. The last 10 years, especially since the year 2000, when we thought Armageddon was about to happen, the world got polarized a lot into isms. All of a sudden, every religion, including Hinduism, has become militant. Today, we have the militant arm of Hinduism showing the vulgarly cheap and dangerous face of Hinduism that our Vedas and our Upanishads don't have. It's this Hinduism that I can't recognize. And in this climate, as I'm mentoring young kids today in India, I realize that textbooks have changed. The hopes and dreams and visions that I had been taught, the stories of our founding fathers, of our freedom struggle, of a world that was considered a global village, that has gone across the world. In America, we are becoming more America-centric. In India, we are becoming more Hindu-centric. In Pakistan, they're becoming Islamocentric. In China, they're becoming Sino-centric. So, you know, the world is getting so polarized that it's a very dangerous place for a 20-year-old to be outside of their culture. So if I were a 20-year-old today and going to America, I would be not as welcome there as I was when I was 20 in 1993. So if you are, we have to think as Indians, as Hindus in a majority Hindu country, as we hate the other in India, we must remember somebody outside is also hating us. So, you know, as a culture, as a world, we have to forego hate for acceptance. We have to make it more comfortable for 20-year-olds to dream big and bigger than their dreams. Because, you know, Papa taught me at a young age that if your hands are this wide, your dreams have to be from one side of the horizon to the other. Because he said, if you realize 1% of those dreams, you would have realized nothing. So keep dreaming. And if you keep dreaming, something will happen. So I think, you know, we are not giving our 20-year-olds environment to breed creativity. We are teaching them at a young age to question the other, to have angst in their minds. My India never told us to be scared of anything. We were told, like, if Gandhi could, Nanga Fakir could bring freedom to Indian shores, all of us can do something big. You know, this land is amazing. Indian 20-year-olds should be conquering the world through their minds, through their creativity and through their unifying passion, because our culture was about unity and diversity, the living, breathing example of what a pluralistic world can be, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, the diversity that we have no other part of the world has. But unfortunately, a very polarized world is robbing 20-year-olds across the world of the same opportunity I was given. Did I answer your question?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks, Avi. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, Suhir.
Hi.
This is Raju Chacha.
Hi, Ranu Chacha.
Let me tell you that you have shown to the family, the friends, your friends, people all over the world who have been watching you, you are a multifaceted person. I have only one simple question to ask you. What about your legacy? As a person, you have to leave a very, very rich legacy, and you have created a very big task for yourself. So I would request you to think about it and what legacy you are going to leave, because you cannot leave without a legacy. That is my question.
So Ranu Chacha, legacy is something that's guided me from a young age. Papa, my father, was a very exacting father from a very exacting mother. And my dadi was tough. Hers was tough love. And we learned at a young age that life was about choices, that life was about living true to your core. And dadi told us that, Dekho ghat hi mein hari ka nivas hai re, tune bahar talash aneko kiye, lekin khud hi mein pyare ko bhool gaye, wo to karta pukar har saas hai re. So when my sister saw my bhua doing puja and vrats and dhong, dadi would say, kya bakwas hai? And my dad, Seema, would say, par bhua kar rahi hai. She said, forgive her, wo pagal hai. So, tum ye kya mandir jane ki zarurat? Have you ever never taken to a mandir? So dadi said, ghat ke andar mandir hai. And so the reason I'm talking about this, not to deride my bhua was an amazing woman. My sister still goes to temples. But the lesson my dadi taught us is that puja paath wo sab karke to theek hai tum karo, but she said agar tum apne mein khush nahi hoge to tum acche insaan nahi banoge. Agar tum apne ko cheat karoge tum kabhi tumhe fulfillment nahi milegi. Agar tum bhooke reh jaoge kuch dream ko achieve karne mein tumhe kabhi tum jeete jeete tumhe hansi nahi aayegi. To phir usko papa would say the next line, kabir ka doha, ki jab aate hain is duniya mein hum log, हम रोते और पूरी दुनिया हंसती है. जब हम जाएं तो पूरी दुनिया को रोना चाहिए और हम हंसते हंसते जाएं. So what they taught us was live today as if it were your last day to live and do everything to the best you can. And when you do it to the best you can, there are no regrets tomorrow. And the legacy you live is to have lived every day to the fullest. I sleep 3 to 3.5 hours like my mother and my brother and my nana. But we read all the books we want to read. We do all the work that we want to do. If I see somebody being oppressed, I speak up. If I see somebody calling another minority person wrong, I speak up. Papa said, don't wait to speak out. Don't wait to achieve your dreams. Don't wait for tomorrow. Pal mein parli hoegi, bahuri karega kab. So do everything you can today. And that is the India that we were taught about, of life and living. We were taught about between Papa, Dadi, Mummy and Nana. The legacy, I think, Ranu Chacha, history will tell what I left or didn't leave. But I will leave happy knowing that I did every day the most I could and with as sincere a desire as possible. Of course, I made a million mistakes. I'm human. But I didn't make them knowingly. I made them by accident. But then I also learned how to correct them. And the next day, I tried to do the same thing without making a mistake. And with each mistake, I learned a lesson. And those lessons have stayed in my head to not repeat them again and again. So I think if we live each day holistically, wholly, and to the best of our abilities, the legacy we leave behind may be something to noteworthy, but that history will tell. It's not up to me to write my legacy, but I can only shape what it might be.
Okay. Thank you so much, and God bless you.
Thank you.
I see another Chacha, Raju Chacha there.
That was Raju Chacha only.
Oh, you asked the question. Okay. Sorry. Raju Chacha.
That was Raju Chacha. Yeah. This is Ajay Chacha.
Hi Ajay Chacha.
Hi, how are you, dear? Abhi kitni tumhari tareef karein kami hogi, but anyway, ye batao that after such a brilliant time and then you had a very bad time and then you again come out, what were your life forces that were working within you to pull out yourself from this kind of a difficult situation? Most of the people tend to succumb down, basically. So just wanted to understand what went into your head that whatever you are today, it is such a pleasure to see you today.
So
after all that difficult second.
So 2018 was tough, but my music, I've learned Indian classical music for now 40 years. And when I had the mini stroke, I was speaking with a slur and I would look at the mirror. I had lost around 30 kilos in 3 weeks. And I would look at something that was, I couldn't recognize the person I saw in the mirror. And I was embarrassed and ashamed to show it to Charlie or mom. I was alone in the city when I got sick. And I hid from them because I didn't want anybody to see me because what I saw in the mirror would frighten me. And I said, ye to main nahi hoon. And I was in denial ki ye main kaise hoon. But I gaata tha to the point mein din bhar gaata tha and the board of the building complained to Seema ki ye bahut music blare karte hain. I didn't have a music system. Seema said to me, what are you playing? I said, I'm just doing my riyaz. But meri awaaz, meri dadi ki awaaz hai, bahut buland hai. So, chhate floor pe logo ko sunai de rahi thi. I sang 8 to 14 hours every day after having the mini stroke. And my voice came back before anything else came back. So my voice came back before anything. And as my voice came back, I started seeing hope. And then my mother came. The doctor had said, take him home for hospice care. Ki matlab ghar pe rakho, jo hoega, hoega. But mom and Charlie decided meko India lana hai. And in the journey back to India, very reluctant, I fought tooth and nail. Because I didn't want to leave my home of New York. In not wanting to leave New York and wanting to remain in Manhattan, I learned how to live again. And I realized how beautiful life is, Ajay Chacha. And at each step, it was humanity, the human race, human diversity, and human geographic diversity of the world that kept me thinking there's so much more for me to see. I have so much more to travel. I have so many more dishes to make, so many more photographs to click, so many more rags to practice that I didn't give up in the end. But I'd given up. I had almost died. And I found strength again because all of a sudden I realized there was so much more still to create and touch. So that's what kept me going. And relatives and family and friends and life, they were good friends to me always. So I bow my head to every human being, all of you here, and many unknown people who would listen to me or send me fan mail, who kept telling me to believe. I owe it to all of the human race who stood by me, and I thank them for having given me strength to cope. So I didn't do it alone. I did it with the help of millions of people around the world.
Great. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone. I think we're running out of time now. If there's anybody else who has questions, we can probably do one more and we can slowly wrap up.
Wonderful. Sumir, you are amazing.
Oh, another cha-cha. Look at my cha-cha. That's so loving.
So, you've left me speechless.
You are too kind, Vishu cha-cha. Chachi, namaste.
Namaste.
But see,
it's truly inspiring, and my admiration for you remains. And
I've done nothing great.
Raju said you're very multifaceted.
No, Chachi. In fact, if I can wrap up with one word, I am not special at all. I am as special, as boring, as talented, as badmash, as kind, as generous, as every other human being. If you see anything special in me, I see it in you. If you see anything wrong in me, see the same in you. Because at the end, we are all the same. What some of us are is a little more fortunate that we were given better chances, bigger hearts, and a little more love than the other. So when you see another who's falling down, support them. When you see somebody angry, forgive them. When you see somebody hungry, feed them. When you see somebody telling you to pray a different way, don't argue, pray with them, and they'll come out, pray with you as well. Because for every adversity, it can be us facing it. When we, you know, a friend of mine, a very dear person, said to me, sitting in New York, they were visiting from India. They said, you know, people who steal their hands should be cut off and they should be beheaded. I love what the Arab countries do for punishment. And I was shocked. How can somebody look at hand chopping and beheading as being punishment? And another friend of mine in America said the same thing to me. Fast forward, her son was sent to jail for a minor crime. She changed her tune so fast when her own son was in jail and wasn't being given clemency, wasn't being forgiven. All of a sudden, this woman who had been pro-death penalty and for life imprisonment, she changed her tune. So I always tell people, don't sit in a glass castle thinking, aap, oro ko jo ho raha, aapko nahi hoga. For every hate that you send out, there'll be five fingers hating you. For every suffering person, it could be your child and your daughter and your son-in-law and your grandchild who could be suffering one day. So when we think of the other as being an extension of us, we realize we are not remarkable. We are all one. Some of us more fortunate than the others. And if we have that, we have to give that good fortune to others we have around us. So I did nothing special. I was very lucky to have all of you as relatives and a lot of incredible strangers who supported me always. Otherwise, I didn't have a degree to go cooking. I didn't have the money to open a restaurant. I didn't have the ability to become the chairman of a department at Culinary Institute of America. At 25, I was teaching at NYU. One of the best universities of America. 25, I was the youngest professor at NYU. At 30, I became a professor at Harvard, teaching over there. I didn't have the degrees to do it. They saw a human being who had a dream. They made me realize my dreams. So it's incumbent upon us to do the same for others. So if there's anything I can tell you, Instamatic is about living every moment with the respect for all human beings and with attention to what the moment is bringing us. If we are mindful, life brings us magic every day.
Yeah, and That's another thing I admire about you, Subir. You're a very good human being and very good
person.
And I think the universe all came together to make you realize your dreams and to help you.
And all of you. Knock. The universe is an echo. I always tell people the universe is an echo. You reap as you sow, as the Bible says. So do good deeds and good deeds will happen to all of us. So in fact, I never do puja ki mera ye bimara usko theek kar do. I always do puja that everybody ailing in the planet today, Lord, please make all of them healthy. I never put a name to it. But that would be selfish of me. I pray for everybody being healthy. And I think all of us should do that. And then our prayers will be answered. Asha, you have kuch keh rahi thi?
Correct, beta.
Thank you.
You
are the same. Okay. You are one of the kindest elders I've had. Thank you for being you.
So proud of you, Subir. Keep it up.
We are so proud of you. I just think there's nobody like you in this world. I tell you, honestly.
You are too kind. Thank you.
Really? Hot one. The more I see you, the more I like you. And
I've done nothing. I've done nothing remarkable. We all have that in us. Please find the divinity in you and you will see it in everybody and you others will see it in you. That's all.
Okay. Subir, thank you so much for your amazing, inspiring talk. And I think I have to say, or if I may say, your sensitivity actually reminds me so much of Mr. Sehgal and his understanding
of too kind.
Humanity. But thank you so much for taking out the time and sharing with us your life. And we hope all the best for you. Thanks a ton. Thank you, everybody, for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Bye.
Thank you very much.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye, everybody. Ah.